You're watching Wide World of Sports in the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships.
Times this century, America's finest skaters have gathered to crown national champions. What began outdoors under blue skies with Teresa Welt Blanchard and Nathaniel Niles winning 18 titles combined has evolved beyond anyone's imagination. Frozen in time are memories of graceful athletes who have dazzled us with their artistry and touched us with their passion.
What a performance, Peggy Fleming.
And already the audience rising on their feet for Scott Hamilton.
I'll do my best for you.
Oh my, oh my, oh my. A standing ovation now for Ty Babylonia and Randy Gardner.
That legacy of unparalleled skating excellence continues today with a woman pursuing her third national title and a man seeking respect and the gold medal that has eluded him. The final national champions of this century are about to be crowned. Amid a setting of Olympic scandal that has obstructed Salt Lake City's magnificent views, the most important figure skating event in the United States is being held here, and national champions are about to be crowned. Welcome to the Delta Center for our continuing coverage of the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. The men's title will be decided live later in our show, but right now the ice dancing championship is on the line, and we turn our attention to the free dance. Hi, everyone. I'm Terry Gannon. I hope you've been with us the past few days over on ESPN and on ESPN2. We've seen a number of young faces that could be back here in the year 2002 for the Olympic Games. We'll see more of them tonight with our live primetime coverage of the ladies' championship along with the pairs. Now, there's no question that much of the attention this week has centered on the ongoing Olympic scandal right here in Salt Lake City. Leslie Visser has been on top of that story. She'll be with us later with the latest details. And meanwhile, ice dancing medals at stake here in the Delta Center. We welcome in Olympic champion Dick Button. And Dick, it's the old story. A lot of changes in ice dancing since last year, but the more they change, the more they remain the same.
Well, welcome to the world of ice dancing.
Exactly.
I mean, that's what it's all about. It's a crazy, complicated, chaotic world, which just happens to be made up of the most beautiful part of skating of all. Now, despite last year's outcry against the block judging of ice dancing at the Winter Olympics at Nagano, the sport has survived, believe it or not. It's instituted some new rules to ease its conscience. But while not much has changed, the beauty, the flow, and the edging of the skaters has remained. Now, there are two top pairs here, Chernyshev and Lane. They have wonderful footwork sequences. They're fast and tricky. Their level of sophistication very high. They skate a tango, but never lose their skating ability or their skating facility. He's a master partner, presents her beautifully. Their power and expression is just phenomenal. The other pair, Shalom and Gates. Now, they do a lot of Torval and Dean-type moves. She even lifts him instead of he lifting her. They do excessive crossovers, but they're wonderful edging, and they're awfully nice to watch.
And Dick, most likely those two will battle it out for the gold medal. We look at the standings after the original dance. Naomi Lang and Peter Chernyshev in first place, ahead of Eve Shalom and Matthew Gates, and then a battle for the bronze medal as well. Debbie Cagle and Oleg Fedyukov just ahead of Beata Hondra and Charles Sinek.
Representing the Lone Star Figure Skating Club in Plano, Texas, would you please welcome now Eve Shalom and Matthew Gates.
So the first couple to take the ice, 19-year-old Eve Shalom and 23-year-old Matthew Gates, who is from England. They're in second place. They've won silver and bronze medals at the Nationals, never the gold.
The music by Mozart, Symphony K and Requiem.
Thank you.
with Christopher Dean and have much influence by him, particularly moves that are long. You'll see wrapping around, under turning.
Free dance lasting 4 minutes in length and worth 50% of the overall score.
Now look at these wraparounds, these turn-unders. Those are the things that are directly attributable to Christopher Dean's influence. Christopher Dean, the partner of Jane Torvill, the phenomenal ice dancers of the 1980-84 Olympic Games. Now look at this lift in which she lifts him. Reminiscent Anasina and Pesera in Romeo and Juliet at the Nagano Olympics. It's a hydroblading move. She's draped over his leg, he in a hydroblading position. Minimum of five lifts that must be incorporated into this program. They have very powerful edges. First goes into a spiral, and then he lifts her. Turning, changing position. The change in that position was one of the requirements of one of the lifts that they must do. Also another is a diagonal footwork, of which this is a part. This is the diagonal footwork that they are doing. That is a requirement, one of the new requirements that will supposedly permit the judges to evaluate their ice dancing at a better level.
Well, they were quoted as saying after the original dance that they need their best performance ever in their careers to jump ahead of Lange and Chernyshev.
Well, I don't think they had that. The program, you know, really their dancing is very beautiful. I like watching them very much. And I like the under-wrapping, turning moves that come out of the influence of Christopher Dean. But the program is not the best. It doesn't develop anything. There are a lot of crossovers used throughout the program. The moves don't develop. Now look here at the way she turns underneath him and then stretches forward. That is very much a typical move. And in this move, I think, was influenced by Anasina and Pesarat, the silver medalist from Nagano in Romeo and Juliet, where she lifts him. But the difference is that this is not a developed move. It's simply a demonstration of the fact that she can lift him. It doesn't go anywhere, and it doesn't tell you anything about their story.
Matthew Gates for technical merit.
Part of their story is that Eve is hearing impaired. You may know that. And she uses a hearing aid to hear the music. She was hit by a car at the age of four. Now, the first of two sets of marks for technical merit, 5.2 up to 5.5, Dick.
Well, I mean, she may be hearing impaired, but she listens beautifully. She knows this music cold, and that's a very wonderful attribute to her.
And now the marks for presentation, 5.4 to 5.7. Those are the marks that the rest of the couples will shoot at. And when we come back, it is the leaders heading into the free dance, Lang and Chernyshev, who will take the ice looking for gold. Welcome back, everyone, to Salt Lake City inside the Delta Center for the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. The free dance underway. Right now, the leaders, Eve Shalom, Matthew Gates. But taking the ice, the leaders after the original dance, Naomi Lang and Peter Chernyshev.
Now, their music is Adios Nonino by Astor Piazzolla, a wonderful piece of music, a tango that is extremely hard to translate to ice. One of the most difficult of all dances. The difficulty of these steps, and how they maintain the Argentine tango influence, the closeness.
This ice dancing competition wide open this year. The five-time champions Punchlin and Swallow have moved on. And by the way, there are two spots available for the world team, so it's critical to but at least gain a silver medal.
Possesses an enormous amount of drama. Really takes a high level of sophistication to perform to this music and also incorporate moves like this, which are required by the very complicated and detailed rules of ice dancing. Look at the way he constantly presents her, keeping her as the influence, the major influence in the ice dance. Remember, the difficulty in ice dancing a tango is that a tango is staccatic. It's close, it's quick. Ice skating usually requires long sweeping moves. It takes an enormous level of sophistication to perform this tango the way they're doing it. Positions. What a level of drama there is and emotion there is in that dance. I mean, I think they're marvelous. It's one of the most, the sexiest, most sensuous dances of all. And to translate it to ice is a really difficult feat. Absolutely first rate. It's Naomi Lang's mother. Do you think that shows pride in your child? That face is wonderful.
Well, they may have the gold for the first time. They were fifth in 97. They won a bronze medal last year, and now we wait and see.
They are truly elegant. Look at this right here. Now, this is one of the many required lifts. Good limber quality, turning positions, changing positions and edges. He has to turn on one of the lifts, and apparently this was that one, although he could also turn on others. But look here at the way the closeness that they have, and the kick of the leg, the remnants of the tango influence. Beautiful.
Here are the judges' marks for Naomi.
Like the other top two men in this competition, Peter Chernyshev, a foreigner, hoping to get his citizenship by the 2002 Olympic Games. He can compete at the Worlds, though. Technical merit marks 5.5 up to 5.7.
And look at how high they are, because it was a wonderful dance. They're really beautiful ice dancers. They're working with Elizabeth Coates and Igor Spielbond, who are sitting next to them. And the, you know, again, the quality, this is the essence of the dance, the way they did it, the romance they had it, all of the elements that go into it. I'm very impressed with them. I think they're wonderful.
And they have the lead. But when we come back, Debbie Cagle and Oleg Fedyukov will take the ice, hoping to medal. They're in third place overall. They'll skate next. Welcome back to Salt Lake City. Don't forget tonight, live and in primetime at 9 p.m. Eastern and Pacific here on ABC Sports, Michelle Kwan tries to win her third U.S. ladies title. Plus, we'll have the pairs free skate, and you can get the latest results of ABC's figure skating coverage on America Online, keyword ABC Sports.
Let's have a warm welcome now for Deborah Cagle and Oleg Fedyukov.
Back at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. And the free dance continues now with Debbie Cagle and Oleg Fedyukov. He is from Moscow originally. She from Norristown, Pennsylvania. They're in third place, and they're trying to get up to the silver medal level.
The music, Fiddler on the Roof. Cagle has suffered several injuries this year. She seems to have recovered from them.
In fact, they qualified at the Eastern Sectional. She injured her knee, couldn't skate in the free dance, but you must be on the ice for that dance. And they went out there, and basically Oleg just held her on the ice, and they qualified.
Sequence that is complicated with changing position and then descending into a hydroblade position.
Unlike the other disciplines, if you're in third place heading into the free dance, you don't control your own destiny in terms of winning the gold medal. But remember the race for silver and for that second spot, perhaps, on the U.S. world team.
Positions, and one of the major lifts that they have to do is this, what we call a Dmitriev lift. We've seen it in the pair skating of Dmitriev and Kazakova, the current Olympic champions, who are pair skaters. See, this couple has a very nice quality about them. They're sort of gentle and romantic. They don't have tension and great speed or in movement, although that lift is quite wonderful, the way they dropped it down and then turned around and came out. They're not as sharp as we saw with Lane and Chernyshev. Very nice closing move at the end of the program. A series of Arabian turning Arabians, as we see here. Very effective. That was a nice ending, but it didn't hit the music, and the music didn't build. It just sort of cut off at the end. But the moves, the Arabians leading into it, were very effective.
Well, Dick, the question now, that second place spot, Shalom and Gage currently occupy that. Can Debbie Cagle and Oleg Fedyukov move up?
I don't think we're going to see any great change.
Our coverage of the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships continues after this message. In a word from our ABC stations.
For technical merit.
Back in Salt Lake City, Terry Gannon, Dick Button, and Leslie Visser with the free dance here. Debbie Cagle, Oleg Fedyukov sitting alongside their coaches, Uschi Kessler and Robbie Kane. Now the first set of marks for technical merit. There they are.
They're just fine. By the way, Uschi Kessler is a famous coach. He worked with Brian Orser and many other skaters. And Robbie Kane is essentially a dancer, came up out of the dance world.
That influence.
Yes, and very effective.
Presentation marks 5.1 to 5.5, and so Cagle and Fedyukov not able to leap up in the second, but the new U.S. champions, Naomi Lang and Peter Chernyshev, wear gold for the first time. Yves Shalom and Matthew Gage capture silver and maybe that second spot on the U.S. world team. Cagle and Fedyukov wear the bronze. Well, the other major story in Salt Lake City this week, of course, the Olympic scandal. For a report on that controversy, let's join Leslie Visser right now. Leslie?
Terry, with 3 years to go, most Olympic host cities are concentrating on building an Olympic village, but Salt Lake City is trying to rebuild its reputation.
I think our community feels a mixture of the anger and the embarrassment of a skater that sprawled on the ice after a needless and stupid fall in front of a world television audience.
In the wake of a scandal that acknowledged outlandish gifts and entertainment for IOC members, including trips to Las Vegas and the Super Bowl, the Salt Lake Organizing Committee named Boston businessman Mitt Romney its new CEO.
In the history of America, time and again, the few sometimes disappoint, but the many get it right. And in this case, the many are thousands of athletes across the globe who, when they hear the name Salt Lake City, they get a jolt.
At the Delta Center, where 200 of the top U.S. skaters are competing for the national championship, the athletes are aware of the corruption, but primarily concerned with 2002.
I still believe in the Olympics, and I still believe in Salt Lake City, and I hope to be there.
You know, what goes on behind the scenes is really not relevant to what we do, so all I can do is go out there and skate well and try and go and represent the USA, hopefully in 2002.
After an Olympic-sized restoration effort, fans and athletes are hoping the focus can return here to the ice. As one trustee said, Salt Lake has endured death by a thousand embarrassments. It's time for meaningful change.
Next, we'll go live with the men. Michael Weiss, can he win his first U.S. title? Todd Eldridge no longer in the way. Is it Weiss's time? We'll find out next.
One medal, two men. One has touched gold before. Timothy Gabel, the 96 junior national champion, is the only American to land a quad. But his next leap, becoming men's champion, is far more daunting. Twice gold has eluded Michael Weiss. Now he's considered the favorite, and he knows respect only comes with finishing first. Is his long wait about to end? Soon, one man will rise to the highest pinnacle in American skating. A live look now inside the Delta Center in Salt Lake City. The clean ice where the men are skating for gold here at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. The men's free skate already underway. The final group, including the overall leaders, moments away from stepping on the ice. Here's the way they stood after the short program. Michael Weiss with the lead, the two-time U.S. silver medalist. High-flying 18-year-old Timothy Gabel right behind him. And then the two surprises, Trifon Zivanovic and Matt Savoy. Hi again and welcome. I'm Terry Gannon. Don't forget, when Michelle Kwan and the ladies take the ice later tonight, we'll be here with their free skate live beginning at 9 o'clock Eastern and Pacific. But right now here in the men's championships, everyone wants to be like Mike. This has been a breakthrough season for Michael Weiss after 2 years in waiting behind Todd Eldridge. The stage is now entirely his. What will he do with it? We welcome in Olympic champion Dick Button to answer that very question. You've got all the answers to all the questions. How about this one?
Well, you know, it's really tough being the crown prince. I mean, everybody expects you to ascend to the throne with newspapers touting your every move. I mean, it's worse than having someone ahead of you to beat. And that's what Michael Weiss is finding out. So the question is, how's he doing? Well, he placed well in a series of competitions in the fall circuit. He worked with Tamara Moskvina for a short time, and it had a good effect on him. He recently had the flu, lost 6 days of practice, and the short program here was lackluster. But this morning, he landed a superb quadruple toe loop that was as good as they come. Now, one thing is for sure. Everybody knows this guy will give this event his very best. Now, a man who knows about giving his best and whose career rests upon the fact that in 1977, he was the Midwestern junior, the Pacific Coast novice men's runner-up champion. Congratulations, well, Brian Boitano.
Thank you, and it was a really good skate for me, too, Dick.
Well, here, everybody is expecting Michael Weiss to win, but Timothy Gabel is poised for an upset. He is skating with none of the expectation that Michael Weiss has, and this may be the key to his success. He's loose, he's laid back, and he's landed quads in competition before. He's also an aggressive competitor, and he's coming into this competition as an underdog. All of these factors could add up to a national title, depending on how Michael Weiss skates.
So, no one's gonna hand it to Michael Weiss. He better bring his A game. There he is, loosening up backstage. Unfortunately, Weiss takes the ice these days without one of his most important team members. Leslie Visser has more on the man behind Weiss's rise and his moving struggle.
Brian's absence here is as much physical as it is financial. He is simply too sick to travel. Well, as for the USFSA, they have now begun to have AIDS awareness seminars at their summer training camps in Colorado Springs. Terry, they know that these skaters are young and need to be informed.
All right, Leslie, thank you. Obviously a positive move. And there is Greg Weiss, not only Michael Weiss's dad, but the grandfather of Annie Mae, of course. And there's Michael warming up, the two-time silver medalist. And Dick, when you look at what he plans here in the free skate, what are we going to look for?
Well, I think the most important thing is the quadruple toe loop. Now, remember, nobody has ever successfully completed a quadruple jump in the national championships. He's also got eight triples, which include the two triple combinations. And his choreography, I think we'll have to judge that for ourselves. But in the short program, he was freer and looser than ever.
Brian, how about Timothy Gabel? In second place, only 18 years of age, and the only American, this is what he's known for, to complete a quad jump in competition.
Well, with Timothy Gabel, you'll see that everything on the list is technical, and I think he's developed in the right way. He's concentrating on the technical side first, because if you don't do the technical stuff, you don't have a chance, and his style will continue to develop as he gets older.
And right behind Timothy Gabel, Trifon Zivanovic in third place. His best finish ever, Dick, a seventh place finish at Nationals.
Well, you know, he's an interesting young man. He's a fine athlete, a good jumper. Now, he still needs to work on his posture, his stretch, and his position. But I'll tell you something, he skates with a lot of flair and boldness.
Expecting big things out of Triffin. And there's Matt Savoy, a freshman in college at Bradley University in Peoria, Illinois. Brian's been consistent all week long.
He sure has, and he's in a perfect position. He's one of the technically best out there, but he has absolutely no pressure. Everything he does is good quality, good jumps, good spins, good skating. He has a great future. What his weakness is his style, and that also will improve with age.
Final moments before this last group takes the ice to compete for the gold medal here at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships. And the order in which they will skate, it'll be Matt Savoy who will start it off. And then Michael Weiss early on will skate. And if you go all the way down the order, Timothy Gable is last. Now, in terms of the quad, does that make any difference at all if he watches Weiss and maybe to see if he needs it or not, Brian?
Well, you know, I think it is difficult to skate last and do a quad, but I don't think Timothy Gable's that kind of skater. I think he knows in his mind what he has planned for here, and he's not going to let anybody else affect that.
You know, one of the worst things is to change your mind at the last minute,
right?
And that causes wreaks havoc on many of these skaters.
You know, the other thing to think about here in Salt Lake City, we're about at 4,200 feet in terms of altitude. It's been another obstacle for these skaters all week long to deal with.
I have seen that affect the skaters all week long. Yesterday, on the one day off, none of the skaters did a complete run through of this long program, and that's very unusual.
Dick, did you ever go to a national championship without having gone through your program in practice?
Well, I'll tell you something. The altitude in places like Colorado Springs and some of the other sites for high-altitude sites were disastrous for certain people. Some skaters with a long, thin kind of body can do it very well. Others have great struggle with altitude and have to adjust it over a long period of time.
And remember, the free skate lasts 4 minutes and 30 seconds, which could be the longest 4.5 minutes of your life, especially at altitude.
And, you know, just an interesting comment about this warm-up. What we saw was almost 100 jumps and probably only one or two spins. So it's interesting to show you what these skaters warm up.
And I know it's always your point, the spins wear you out, and then you try to do the triple jump at the end of your program.
They also warm you up faster.
Uh-huh.
Competing next, he represents the Illinois Valley Figure Skating Club, located in Peoria, Illinois. Would you please welcome now Matthew Savoy.
So here's Matt Savoy, 18 years of age. He was the junior national champion in 1997. This is his second trip to the senior nationals, and he is in fourth place.
The music, The Last of the Mohicans, by Trevor Jones and Randy Edelman.
And Matt always makes me feel secure watching him. I never have the feeling that he's going to miss anything. He's like a technical robot to me.
Well,
beautiful triple axel, triple toe.
There's nothing better than that. Now this next triple combination, triple flip, triple toe loop. Wonderful revolution
in
the
air. Can't open up better than that.
Nation spin, not a bad position at all, and that's very nice, dropping back into a backside spin.
This free skate worth two-thirds of the overall score, and Matt Savoy in fourth place, looking of course to medal, but you never know, might jump a long way.
And you see right there, he just took a nice long rest. He's playing this smart. He opened with two big guns. He took a little rest, and he should do that through the whole program if he's a smart competitor.
Wonderful. You know, he's really got steady, secure revolution. I mean, that's as solid as it comes. One other thing you notice about his skating is how flexible he is.
That was a double salt cow.
Yeah, he's looking a little bit tired. You can tell someone's tired when their arms start hanging a little bit. They go a little bit slower. Their mouth opens a little wider. And you can tell that he's starting to feel the fatigue of the altitude.
Here's another slow resting period within the program.
And there's no worse feeling than getting in the middle of your program and going, I am so tired right now. I don't know how I'm going to make it to the end and do all the tricks that I have to do.
Saved that one.
He sure did.
Did you see that free leg landing in front of him as he landed the back edge? I find one thing that is could use improvement in his skating is his arm movements. They seem to flail a lot, to move without real connection to the rest of him or to the point. In this case, I think sometimes less is more. That what should have been a triple loop, it was a double. That forward spiral, not finished, not extended.
You made a good point too, Dick, about the spins being so exhausting to do. It really is difficult to do a spin.
A fast spin in particular. But when they're done right, they're spectacular. Look at this. Triple lutz, double lutz, double toe loop. Back to spin.
Technically, a really good program. You know, I think
a little
he caught
slow.
The altitude okay. Yeah, he was a little slow.
But Matthew Savoy with a chance to medal here in Salt Lake City in fourth place, trying to move up with that effort here in the free skate. Have his marks, and then Michael Weiss, the favorite and the leader, will take the ice when the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships continue after this from our ABC stations. Back at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships, the men's free skate.
Here you can see his triple axel combination, the increased difficulty of going into it from a spread eagle. He's quick in the air, and he maintains speed enough to do a great triple toe loop afterwards.
Matt Savoy, and there'll be two sets of marks, the first for technical merit, 5.6 to 5.8.
Well, those are very strong. You can see that he's a solid competitor, a solid technician all the way around. He has every element going for him.
You mentioned a moment ago to his coaches, he almost passed out about halfway through his program.
Well, I think that's reflected in these slightly lower marks.
Lower for presentation. And now, the man who thinks that his time has come. There's his wife, Lisa, one of his choreographers. There have been those throughout his career that have doubted him and said he'd never be a championship skater. This is his time to prove them wrong. In first place, after the short program, Michael Weiss.
Now, just remember that the quadruple toe loop will be the first jump that he does.
And this is a perfect skating order for him. He's gotten to use the full warm-up, and he's gotten to get off the ice so that he can have a little bit of rest before he does this.
This is the setup for his quadruple toe loop.
And still, Michael Weiss has never done the quad in competition. He has come so close at the U.S. Nationals. That one wasn't. You know, I don't care how well he was placed in this performance. The difficulty of that jump opening a program is always tough. But look at how wonderful those triple axle, triple toe combination was.
Combination. Those are both done really well.
You see, this choreography is much more sophisticated than what we saw with Matt Savoy just earlier.
And you know, I think what's helped him is he's been more consistent this season, and he's been in more control going into his jumps and in the air, and it makes the audience feel relaxed, and it puts the judges at ease.
He has a triple axel planned here. He needs this, and he got it. And you know, also, there's another point about his entrances and exits to jumps that I think has improved. They seem steadier and more complete, less landings, for example, on the back inside edge, and then having to switch over to the outside edge. That's an improvement. You see, he's completing that jump, but he didn't complete it well. It didn't fly, it didn't sing.
It was a little far forward.
And that's called catching the edge instead of hooking the camel. Anytime you're on a forward edge in skating, you can be in trouble. You can lose that edge at any time.
You know, the good thing that Michael Weiss is, he's always been good at not letting a mistake at the beginning of the program affect the rest of the program. And he's really fighting through this, and he's doing this stuff after a fall on the quad.
He's skating quite conservatively. And this, a triple Lutz. Oh, good. And that was the last difficult move he had.
You know, he's got to feel good about that program.
Yep.
I mean, he didn't do the quad, but he did everything else that he needed to do.
And this camel jump over sit spin. Very well, good for him. Good for him. You know, I don't think it was his greatest program ever, but it was an awfully good one. And the choreography was sophisticated and complete. The jumps were steady and secure.
His wife Lisa had a subtle smile on her face. Wasn't his best program, had a couple of mistakes, but it may have been good enough to win the championship. Levin scores, and then Shepard Clark will take the ice. He's trying to medal here at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championship. Back to Salt Lake City in a moment. Back in Salt Lake City, Timothy Gabel skates last, and he now knows there is some room at the top. Michael Weiss's program just finished. He sits next to his longtime coach, Audrey Wissiger.
Now, look at this quadruple right there. He has all the revolution he needed.
The free leg was still in front. He couldn't quite hold the landing, but he had all the revolution, and this was an excellent combination right here. First, a triple toe loop, a triple flip, and then a triple toe loop. That was good. But watch here as he enters this camel spin. Watch his left leg, and right there, he turns suddenny too soon. He didn't wait for the hook, and he was out of it.
Perseverance may be the operative word for that program. Now, the first set of marks for technical merit, 5.7, the rest 5.8.
Oh, but all of those marks are very high and very solid for him. What can I tell you?
And marks for presentation, 5.8s and 5.9s.
Those are pretty strong, and you know what? Timothy Gable knows exactly what's going on backstage. Nothing's going to get by him. He's going to have to skate for it.
So it's Michael Weiss with the lead over Matt Savoy, but remember, Timothy Gable skates last.
Please welcome our next competitor, Shepard Clark.
And here is Shepard Clark, the 27-year-old originally from Atlanta, in his 10th trip to the Senior National Championships, and he finished fourth last year. That was his best finish ever. He is currently in fifth.
He's skating to a montage of Richard Strauss music.
And Shepard has so much power, and one of the secrets for skating well in this event will be him being able to conserve something for the end, because he goes 100% at the beginning sometimes, and he doesn't have anything left for the end.
His opening combination, triple axel, triple toe loop. Triple axel, double toe loop, and that was just fine. The problem is to maintain his concentration, not only on the big moves, but the little ones. Is a triple lutz. First grade, first grade. And here a triple axel again.
I threw in that double sow cow as a combination to cover up the mistake on the landing of the triple axel.
Well, you know, that's one of the absurdities of the rules of skating today, is that if you make a mistake in one way, you have to re-choreograph your program as you're skating it. That does not lead towards security or good control.
Shepard told us earlier this week that he has been diagnosed with attention deficit disorder. Millions of Americans have that. Unfortunately, in skating, the drugs that are usually prescribed are not allowed.
That's why it's such a pleasure to see him do well and to see that he is controlling his problems. Now, what happened there was he was supposed to have done a triple salco in the first place. When he only did a double, he laid in another triple salco. He should have just forgotten the second one. Straight line steps. Jump.
He is really skating well.
Good
for him. This is much better than the practices that I've seen.
If he can maintain his jumping ability and not fall apart, he can always prove himself as a big, powerful, stylish skater with good stretch and good command of the ice.
Here's an important triple for him. The premature blood. It's the second one because he has to do this in combination because the first one was not in combination.
It was a double.
All right, that was a double.
Another double loop in.
Well, I cannot tell you that even though the program was slow, the fact that he landed so many of these jumps, the fact that he completed things is such a tribute to his own accomplishments in this year. I must say I'm very proud of him.
Coming up next, Damon Allen in sixth place after the short program. He'll take the ice when we come back. Back in Salt Lake City, the Delta Center. And don't forget tonight, live coverage beginning at 9 o'clock Eastern and Pacific. Michelle Kwan going after title number 3 and two 13-year-olds that you have to see. Also, the pairs free skate, and you can get the latest results of ABC's figure skating coverage on America Online. Keyword, ABC Sports. And there's Shepard Clark right next to his coach, Slavka Button.
And here you see his opening jump, the triple axel. Right in the air, beautiful, beautiful, but he doesn't carry enough speed. He has to turn this into a double instead of the triple that he had planned.
5.5, 5.4, 5.3. First set of marks for technical merit. 5.3. You got to be happy for Shepard Clark. It's been a tough year. He lost his father this autumn, passed away.
5.4, 5.7, 5.2. It's an interesting diversion there. He's really got very good style, and I think that the choreography was fine. I think the fact that his reputation of not being able to land jumps has hurt him up to this time. That's why this performance is such a satisfying one.
He's got to be pleased with it, and that puts him in third place in terms of those that have skated here in the free skate.
Let's have a warm Salt Lake welcome now for Damon Allen.
So here's 25-year-old Damon Allen. He has missed two of the past three national championships with injuries. First, a stress fracture in his leg in 96, then a knee injury in 98. So this is a comeback of sorts for him. He is in sixth place.
And if you notice, looking at where he trains, Colorado Springs, altitude, I'm wondering if that's going to help him against these other guys.
Nice triple left, nice one. He has very good back position. Nothing sloppy about his skating. Very stylish. Skate triple axel.
Really good, he just pitched forward on that. It was beautiful in the air.
Should have been a triple flip. He elected to do a double. This should be a triple toe loop. Now look at his position here. And the forward inside edge that he's skating on.
Now what a skater does is he tries to regroup. He tries to forget about the mistakes in the beginning and try not to make any more until the end of the program.
The music, Slaughter on 10th Avenue from Cafe Noir.
Here's an important triple, another triple axel.
Same problem again. That's unfortunate because that really mars the entire program and makes two major deductions. Not mandatory deductions, but it'll cost.
I think Damon's a really well-rounded skater, and I think that every step he takes is controlled and calculated, and that makes everybody feel at ease.
Doubled that and then stepped out of it is again going to emphasize to the judges of the fact that he's not in control with his jumping.
Well, he told us in practice that he's been having problem with this long program and that a lot of jitters coming in. He was concerned about it.
He's a very stylish skater. Here, very good.
Nice triple south pound.
Ah, and there's a forward flying sit spin. We haven't seen that in a long time. And as nice as that was, it does not equal what Hayes Jenkins, the Olympic champion from 1956, could do when he could pop and pancake one of those flying sit spins that would knock you out of their seats.
So Damon Allen, the 25-year-old from Rockford, Illinois, his effort here in the free skate in sixth place after the short, trying to move up. Straight ahead, Trifon Zivanovic, a name to remember. He'll take the ice right after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Back live with the men's free skate, Michael Weiss, along with his mom, Margie. And on the other side of him, you can see, yeah, there she is, Annie May. Could he be the new U.S. men's champion? Not that Annie May cares at all right now. Meanwhile, Damon Allen waits for his marks along with his coach, Kathy Casey. There's Trifon Zivanovic on the ice warming up. He skates next. And don't forget, Timothy Gable, who is in second place, he skates last. Armed with a quad. And a long wait now for Damon Allen's marks. I want to ask you, Brian, watching his program, you mentioned the altitude and the fact that he trains in Colorado. Did it help him at all?
Well, you know what I think hurt him are the falls. When you take as many falls as he did, and many mistakes, it's exhausting and it takes the wind out of your sails.
So the marks for technical merit, there they are, 4.9 up to 5.4.
And they're so low that he is not going to move certainly upwards.
5.5.
These marks slightly better because he's a very nice stylist. He has good control of the choreography. It was complete. It was a good complete package except for the one thing that's most important here, and that is his triple jumps.
So it puts Damon Allen in fourth place, right behind Shepard Clark. Your current leader, Michael Weiss, Matt Savoy in second place, and then Shepard Clark in third.
He competes on behalf of the All-Year Figure Skating Club, Culver City, California. Would you please greet now Trifon Zivanovic.
But here's 23-year-old Trifon Zivanovic. His fourth trip to the Senior Nationals. He placed seventh a year ago, but he's in third place, so one of the surprise stories this week here in Salt Lake City. And he does control his own destiny when you're looking at the podium.
Triffin is such a hard worker, and he's worked mostly this year on his presentation and his musicality. But he has improved in every way.
The speed he has going into this triple axel. Notice how low he was on that forward edge. He just sunk down into that edge and lifted it up.
And he had planned a triple axel combination for that. So what that means is the next triple axel he does, he has to do it in a combination. And it's going to be later, and he's going to be tired.
Beautiful flip. And that was the combination.
There you go.
But it wasn't a combination because he put two turns in between the two jumps. So that will not count as a combination.
Now here's his next triple axel, the one. He's a little fatigued, but he has to do this in combination because he didn't do the first one in combination. One of them has to be in combination. There we go. He did it. Good for him.
Yeah.
That's a thinker and a fighter. That boy's thinking on his feet.
Did you notice how much easier that was and lighter for him? You know, the interesting part about him is that he's not only a superb athlete, but he has wonderful attack. He really pushes this. He doesn't lay back in any way. Now, the other thing is that he could stretch up a little more and be a little less round-shouldered, and I think that would help his line a lot.
Triffin, the only man in this last group not to have won a junior national championship. By the way, since 1981, every men's champion at this event has won a junior national title of one kind or another.
You know, watching all this in between footwork and all the presentation, you can really tell that he has worked on his style and his presentation. And I think it's a great character for him. It's a real smart move to do West Side Story.
Rotate away from the circle, but he saved it beautifully.
He sure did. And I like how long he holds his landing positions. He does it more than any other man in this competition.
See, one thing you get is the character of the role that he's playing. I hope that is not lost on the judges.
It's not lost on the audience.
Footwork.
Now you're going to see him add some acting in this because he doesn't really have any triples left, so he's just going to push it for all it's worth.
Again, you see that double axel. A little weak on the landing. But okay.
Good job.
Oh, nice. Really fun.
Our first standing ovation of the evening.
Get them up and out of their seats.
Yeah.
Griffin Zivanovic.
Woo!
Jared Ascani, the coach. Wow.
He's going to break those cards.
Michael Weiss watching with his wife and baby. He liked it. He hopes it wasn't too good, though, in terms of the judges. He has the lead right now. Triffin Zivanovic trying to steal the lead. But Timothy Gable with the quad takes the ice next.
National titles on the line here. We've got the men's free skate at the State Farm U.S. Figure Skating Championships, along with Leslie Visser, Brian Boitano, Dick Button.
Six,
I'm Terry Gannon. There's Trifon Zivanovic after what may have been the performance of his life.
Here's his triple axel double toe. Now watch his left foot. He doesn't get the greatest takeoff, but he spins a rotation, and he has enough to land it and do a double toe afterwards.
The judges mark for Trifon Zivanovic.
Here you see it again.
Merit.
The triple axel, you see his tight
5.
Feet,
6,
the clean
5.
Rotation,
7,
and going
5.
Into that
5.
Double toe loop.
And I can hear the
5.
Crowd
7.
React already, because they've
7.
Heard some of the
5.
Marks
5.
Being read.
5. 5.
The first set 5. For technical 7. Merit.
Well, they are good marks. I mean, you know, he's really an interesting 6. Skater. Because, and this, I'm sorry that this doesn't quite reflect it, but he is a strong skater who has a good on impact. He's an honest skater. He's a straightforward skater. There's nothing phony about it, and that's very nice to see.
So Dickie's in second place. Mark's not good enough to unseat Michael Weiss at the top. It's Weiss, Zivanovic, and then Matt Savoy as the final skater. Timothy Gable takes the ice in second place after the short program, and he controls his own destiny, and of course the quad jump will loom large. He is the only American ever to complete it in competition.
And how relaxed and laid back is this guy? He was just clapping for Trifon, who was skating right before him. Most guys are so uptight and trying to surround themselves in a bubble that they don't even notice anything around them.
Music, Malaguena. And that ease of that Salchow,
it's a nice
tells
warm-up.
You his story.
Going to be an important combination for him, a triple axel, triple toe combination.
And an unusual one. He can do those triple axels like they're, you know, they're absolutely no trouble at all.
Well, you know, Timothy Gable's been off the ice since the warm-up for over 40 minutes. It is very difficult to keep your warm-up at the off the ice at the same time, saving enough energy for once you get back on the ice.
Well, if he makes this quadruple jump, a quadruple Salchow, what a pity. If he had made that, it would have overcome the other axle problem without any doubt. But two falls and two major jumps are devastating.
Now he has to regroup, because remember, not only medals on the line here, but spots on the world championship team that will go to Helsinki, Finland. Three spots available for the men.
This and program by Alexander Julin.
And regrouping is right. He does have to regroup, because the exhaustion and the addition of the exhaustion that adds to take two big falls like that, it just cuts your momentum, and you have to start from scratch again.
He has another triple axel planned right here.
That was a very nice triple axel.
That was a beauty.
That's a testament to his competitiveness.
Triple Lutz jump. Footwork. He's very quick.
Mm-hmm.
into a triple loop.
And you can see how easy those triples are for him. At the end of the program, he looks like he's still pretty fresh.
Combination spin. An okay spin. Not a great one. But that's a nice back cross foot. If you could only get him to stand up straighter, stretch out more, I think he'd be more adept at doing this kind of a program with this kind of character skating.
Now he has a triple sow double toe plant here, and I'm wondering if he might add the triple toe that he wasn't able to do. Nope. Let's see. No, he didn't do that at the beginning of the program, so he was allowed to add that.
Sit spin. Good center. Well, that's a disappointment for him. The things that he does so well were the things he couldn't do today.
And there still has not been a quad jump at the U.S. Nationals, a successful one at least. We're back with his marks in a moment. Timothy Gable sitting next to his coach, Carol Heiss Jenkins, the 1960 Olympic champion.
And look at this slow motion, first of his triple axel. Now, watch the way he drops down into this forward edge and steps right up into it, but doesn't make the full revolution and therefore blows it. And on this quadruple salchow, he had all the revolution right there, but he wasn't fully turned. Good tight revolution, but he didn't make it fully. And as a result, he couldn't hold the landing.
Now the question is, can Timothy Gable hold on to second place and the silver medal, or at least stand on the podium, the first set of marks?
Well, those are very good marks for his technical merit, I've got to tell you that. You know, that is not a, that is nothing to be ashamed of.
And the presentation marks, and Timothy Gable will stand on the podium. He ends up in third place. You see the judges' placements, a few fours and some threes, and the 18-year-old from Rolling Meadows, Illinois, just finding out that he will wear the bronze medal.
I'll tell you, I think he barely made that. You know,
yeah,
but what the margin doesn't count.
There you go. Michael Weiss on top. He wins his first U.S. gold medal. But that man right there, thrilled to be on the podium and perhaps on the world team. Normally the top three go, but an international committee of the USFSA makes that decision. Trifon Zivanovic wears the silver medal, right behind Michael Weiss for the first time in his career. And the rest of the names and some of those we may see back here in 2002 at the Olympics. Take a look at who had the edge in this free skate, guys.
Well, with the quads and the triples, there were no quads, so we can't give anybody the edge. With the triples, it actually, that the graphic is wrong. It's Weiss that has it because he did eight triples versus Zivanovic's seven. He didn't do a triple loop, Zivanovic.
Well, I think I'd give Weiss the nod with the spins, but the footwork, I think, again, we're a little bit wrong. Both of them had good footwork. And finally, one point is that I think both of them had interesting artistry and were unusual in that sense.
And Trifon Zivanovic, never higher than seventh place, now the silver medalist. And Michael Weiss, the gold medalist for the first time. Timothy Gable wears bronze, and most likely we will see those three at the World Championships in Helsinki, Finland. So the gold medal has been decided here in the Delta Center in Salt Lake City. Michael Weiss, he's had critics. He's had people say that he could never be a championship skater. He is now. The ladies come up tonight. Right now, we go back to our Wide World of Sports studio in New York and join John Saunders. John?